What I'd like to talk about today is 21st century medicine and the revolution it's going to bring toward healthcare. There are two strategies that have fundamentally changed 20th century medicine. One, the genome project, and two, systems biology. The Genome Project, of course, gave us access to all of the variability in the human genome and our ability to correlate this variability with wellness and/or with disease phenotypes. Systems biology has given us a far richer palette. First, it's defined some of the central terms of 21st century medicine. The idea of a systems approach to disease, that is, systems medicine, employs a holistic, global, data-rich approach to analyzing the complexity of disease. We also believe that healthcare should be predictive, preventive, personalized, and participatory. And we call this P4 medicine or P4 healthcare. Thinking about it, one realizes that P4 healthcare has two major domains. One is wellness, that up until recently it's been almost entirely ignored, and the second is disease. Systems biology also has given us a very deep understanding of biological complexity. I remember starting at Caltech in the 1970s being really distressed by the fact that humans were enormously complicated organisms. We didn't have good ways of talking about that complexity. Later that came to be systems biology. Nor did we have the instruments for generating data that could let us begin to comprehend this complexity. So, what is absolutely critical in understanding human complexity is what we call dense phenotyping. That is, analyzing data that include genomic, omic data, physiologic data, digital health data, microbiome, and many other kinds of data, because it's only in that context can we access the features that are proxies for the hundreds of biological systems that operate in a human being. Systems biology has also given us the tools to do high throughput generation of information from humans, be it proteomics, genomics, metabolomics, single cell biology. Systems biology has also given us the computational platforms that will let us draw in, analyze, integrate, visualize, and even model the complexities of human data. And of course, what systems biology has also made us realize is that one can take the enormities of big data generated on humans and translate it into hierarchical biological systems that mediate in the normal individual development, physiology, and aging. And of course, when disease perturbed, cause diseases. Comparing the normal and disease perturbed networks gives fundamental new insights into biomarker discovery, the identification of drug targets, and even biological mechanisms. So, systems biology then has really transformed healthcare. It has given us a sharp conceptual view of what idealized healthcare should really be all about. And what I want to talk about next is a program that ISB started in 2014 to quantify scientific wellness. What we did was to take 108 of our friends and persuade them to do dense phenotyping at three different periods over a 9-month period of time. The data we generated was a complete genome sequence, blood draws every 3 months to analyze roughly 1,200 analytes, that is clinical chemistries, proteins, and metabolites. We analyzed the gut microbiome every 3 months to quantify its species, and we did a quantization of the digital self using a Fitbit and other devices. These generated a data cloud that, when analyzed, led to actionable possibilities, which, if acted upon by the individual, would lead to improved wellness and or the amelioration or the avoidance of disease. The actionable possibilities came from taking these data features to the literature and identifying actionable possibilities. We started with perhaps 200, but as we integrated the different types of data together, these expanded probably to represent more now than 1,000 different possibilities. So each individual has a unique list of actionable possibilities that are necessary for optimizing their wellness. We used wellness coaches to deliver the actionable possibilities to each of the wellness pioneers, as we called them. And the coaches were successful in 70% of the time persuading individuals to act upon the actionable possibilities. This wellness program was enormously successful in two different dimensions. First, most of the people felt their health really was improved and wanted to continue on the program. And in that regard, we started AirVail, a company that brings scientific wellness to consumers. And they now have more than 5,000 clients, an enormous number of different data clouds to be analyzed. The second point was the data were really revelatory in showing how powerful data clouds can be in discovering new human biology and aspects about disease. And I'll talk about four features. One, in the 108 pioneers of the million or so comparisons that we could make, we found 3,500 statistical correlations between a data bit in one data type and data bits in the five other data types. These correlations brought together systems we had no idea interacted, and they could be deconvoluted into more than 70 communities. And each of these communities represented analytes and features that clustered together around different aspects of physiology or different aspects of disease. Indeed, they represented a brand new statistical approach to the discovery of both biomarkers and drug target candidates. Number two, we were able to use genome-wide association data on 125 or so diseases in conjunction with the individual's complete genome sequence to identify genetic risk for each of these individuals in each of these diseases. This gave us the capacity then to follow very closely high-risk individuals for a disease, say, like Alzheimer's, and at the earliest transition point begin therapy to reverse the disease before it ever manifests itself as a phenotype. And indeed, this is going to be the true preventive medicine of the 21st century, reversing disease at early transitions before it ever manifests itself. Point number three is we were able to bin the 5,000 individuals into 10-year decades, 0 to 20, 20 to, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, up to 80 to 90, and look at the patterns of regulation of expression of the three classes of analytes. The patterns of expression lost in control as people aged, and we could use this age-dependent loss of control to calculate for each individual a biological age, that is the age your body says you are, rather than the age your birthday says you are. For example, 300 people in the AirVail program had diabetes, and on average, they were 6 years older than their chronologic age. Likewise, in people intensely exercising with the Fitbit, as opposed to those who did not, they were 3 years younger than their chronologic age. So the younger you can make your biological age, the weller you are. And indeed, we can use this biologic age in N of one experiments on each of us to optimize how we age in a healthy manner, with the objective being that we should be able to move into our 90s mentally alert and physically capable. The fourth data observation was in the 5,000 individuals in the AERVALE program, we saw more than 100 wellness to disease transitions. We were able to use the data clouds to identify biomarkers at the transition point, and we could then subject these individuals immediately to therapy if it existed, or we could use systems approaches to determine the appropriate therapy for bringing the individual back to normal. And again, this is the preventive medicine of the 21st century. We're actually using Alzheimer's disease as our first model of a chronic disease, one, to find the earliest transition point, and two, to use a powerful new multimodal therapy to bring the individual back to normal. And the early results look very promising. So all of these things together point to precisely what 21st century medicine is. It's a medicine that has the vision of being predictive, preventive, personalized, and participatory. And it's a medicine, P4 medicine, that is achieved by scientific wellness. For scientific wellness achieves each of the four P's in a very, very effective manner. In 2016, ISB and Providence St. Joseph's Health, a very large nonprofit health center, 50 hospitals, 5 million patients a year, 15 million clinical health, electronic medical records, and so forth, affiliated with the idea of bringing this 21st century medicine to Providence St. Joseph's. Already we have two major clinical trials that are using dense phenotyping, and these are on scientific wellness and on Alzheimer's, and the initial results in both look very promising. So the question you should be asking yourself now is, are any of you in hospital systems that are practicing 21st century medicine? I'll guarantee almost for certain the answer is no. And the question is, how long will it take for you to move to 21st century medicine?